Here's a language, and here's a brain. And this is a brain on language? Just look at this brain. In case you're not up to date on all the science, there's a whole lot going on here. There are neurons and glial cells, capillaries and myelinated axons, all this anatomy. But the sexiest stuff to focus on has been the nerve cells in your cerebral cortex. That's this outside layer here. The inside looks whitish. This stuff looks gray, hence the terms white matter and gray matter. The first real evidence of the brain's role in language came not from observing normal, healthy brains using language, but from damaged brains. This started back in the 1800s, when pioneering researchers dissected the brains of aphasiacs. The ancient Greek word aphasia simply means speechlessness. Patients suffering from aphasia have head injuries that disrupt their abilities to understand or produce speech. It turns out that specific linguistic difficulties were associated with lesions in specific parts of the cortex. The logic involved in pinning down these language centers of the brain is pretty simple. If someone doing action A has a healthy region B, but someone else who has damage to region B can't do A, then it looks like region B is necessary for action A. In 1861, a French surgeon named Paul Broca began to study the brains of aphasiacs and hunted down just such a region apparently crucial for speech production, a region we today call Broca's area. Inspired by Broca's findings, a German doctor and anatomist, Karl Wernicke, went and found another such region, this one linked to linguistic understanding. As you might have guessed, that region is called Wernicke's area. A little side note for you anatomy buffs or anyone looking for extra credit. Today's most widely used system for cutting the brain into regions was proposed by another German anatomist, Corbinian Brodmann. This outer surface of the brain we've been admiring has over 24 of these Brodmann areas. Broca's corresponds to Brodmann areas 45 and 44, while 22 is home to Wernicke's area. In your brain specifically, both of these regions are most likely in your left hemisphere. With all of the technological leaps forward we've made in brain imaging since Broca's day, looking inside the brain to see what's lighting up where has obviously become even more important. But don't let the aphasiacs mislead you. What we're searching for inside the brain isn't necessarily straightforward. The way researchers speak about it, it's not as if neuroimaging gives us the exact brain location of language or of love or any other human concept. Instead, we get to see the areas of the brain, the activation of the actual brain cells that are involved in performing a task. These days, there are two fields that tackle our topic of the day,
which is language and the brain, in case you've already forgotten.
The first one, neurolinguistics, makes an entire discipline out of the kind of research we've been chatting about. Psycholinguistics, a related field, as the name implies, is crazy about language, but it takes on general questions like, how do humans acquire language? And how do humans speak and understand? With a focus on the role of the mind in these activities. The two fields inform each other, meaning that there's a high degree of interdisciplinarity here. With all this stuff about the brain going through your brain, think for a minute about two 20th century models of language. In model number one, human language is a collection of behaviors that are conditioned by external stimuli. Verbal behavior, language, that gets a favorable response will be reinforced and repeated. This is a perspective called behaviorism, and it places the brain in a background role. Model number two is a very popular linguistic model of language, known as nativism. It holds that language is an innate mental faculty. Grammar isn't just a linguistic concept anymore, it's actually born into every healthy human brain. But instead of marginalizing the brain by focusing on external behavior and operant conditioning, and instead of bringing linguistics to the brain by mapping grammatical concepts onto brain areas, perhaps we could be a little more considerate of what the brain is actually doing when we articulate our understanding of language. Yes, being that specific with our familiar general academic terms will require a bit more intellectual muscle than ignoring the brain or slapping stickers like language, grammar, speech onto some part of your cortex. But consider it an invitation to get to know your brain and your brain on language a bit better. Thanks for learning with me.